visuality is that property of vision which is same in all visions, including visions of future and visions of hell and visions of whatever. All visions, including, you know, is that property is common. That is visuality. Orality is that property is common in all oral situations, voice situations. It could be Akashvani in your head, voice or something, but it's common. So, this era is the era of visuality because orality has shrunk to intimate spaces, some private spaces. By and large, oral things, significant oral things are very private. Now, you know, who said what, you know, what. There is very little of public space. Music is adding some public space into orality. Musical cognitions are there, but not much. Now it's become secondary to, if you want to hear a song, you have to go to YouTube to even see that song. It's sometimes very irritating, but, and then you, if you close it, then even that closes now. There's no way to keep listening, except iPad. I found a way, you can keep listening without seeing. iPad, one can do that. So, there is, and the result is, best of songs, actually old songs, are not there on YouTube because they are pictorially, they are not there. Best songs, or the retro songs, no? Sindhi wale. We used to hear earlier, we can't hear because their video is not available in the public domain. So, there is, we are living in a lot of visual culture. And this visual culture, it's you know, we can see it, people keep saying next generation, next generation. Next generation now has become 2 years, 3 years. Because we had a Facebook generation, no, just 3 years back. And now there are other kind of generations are coming through. And these are visual culture is shifting a lot. And the visual content in our experience has become very large. Extremely large visual content. We don't know how to create homes around or how to be at home with visual culture. That's a different issue. A lot of thinking, a lot of concern among elders that language is shrinking, the total vocabulary is shrinking, you know, and pedagogy is going haywire, is becoming visual. Visualization, you know, even knowledge has to be visualized, and everywhere visualization has become big. But there may be good things in that, but usually there is a preponderance of visual culture, which means preponderance of colors. Because one element of visuality, which is where multitude is involved, which is giving variegation into it, is color. There are visuality, which is common in all visual phenomena, including visualizations and imaginations. Image is also imagination, term is coming out of visual. We could have had term which is different from, like Kalpana doesn't give you a sense of vision or sense of sound, Hindi term. Telugu terms or Indian terms will not give that. But imagination is like image. And they have to qualify, no, imagination includes also non-images and things like that. But that is a term which has come. So image has become very significant. And which is, and if visuality, which is common in all visions, all states of vision, has many other features. It has features like space-time. There are special features it has. There is left-right to vision, no, down-up to vision. Special features are there. There are temporal features like flows, etc. in vision. There are temporal features in vision. And then there is color. the spatiotemporal features are some things which are recorded only partially. Colors are also recorded partially, because when you think of recording something, you can record colors perfectly, quite well. And recording spatiotemporality is also there. When you are doing painting, there is that patching of colors are there. But when somebody sees it, those patches create an image in that person. So that patches have recorded that image. It is 2D patches, so they have recorded that image. This record is able to create, with the help of our memory, a full-blown holographic 3D kind of image out of the 2D color patches. Now 3D image is created. This 3D image is to be recorded back. You have to collapse it down. Collapse it to 2D and then enlarge it, somebody else sees it, enlarge it to 3D. This process is happening with the realm of image. In this process, space-time is there, some amount of recording is done, spatial features. But these spatial features are riding not in terms of coordinate system, but in terms of colors which are occupying this coordinate system. At this place is this patch of color, at that place is that patch of color. When you're recording, recording has been done in a lower dimension. The reality could be 3D, but when you record a picture or a paint, it's in 2D. So this is interesting theorem. You should, people should Google around if possible with this, which is holographic, not theorem actually, principle, it's a conjecture. Holographic principle, you should see that. That when we talk of ND, the talk becomes N minus 1D. You have all the colors of this room, all the features of details of all the information which is there in this, formations of color which is in the room, can be captured in a photograph. Is it true that a higher dimensional reality can be squeezed into a lower dimensional reality? Can we find ways so that the squeezing is done without without losing any information? The holographic principle states that it should be possible to squeeze all information in 3D into 2D. And then from this 2D, create a 3D. That is what holograms are. They are certain, so 2D films which are projected and to create a 3D image. It's possible to create 3D image, and man has known it from ancient time to create 3D image, but now it can be done technologically. But what I'm trying to say, I want to get back to it, is that color is the only thing which is getting recorded. It is getting recorded in a file of say 600 by 400 points. It is getting recorded in some other form, and in a photograph. In a film it's getting recorded in some other way, and in paintings it's getting recorded in some other way, those colors. But the only, in visuality, the only thing worth recording is color. And if you look at, this has given rise to something called an image file, in which there is no information except color. Color where? So you have a frame 600 or 400, this color, this color, that color, that color, that color. It's also true about sound. Sound can, music can have so much of it, you know, so much of reality is there in music when somebody is listening. But when you're recording a music, you only have amplitude and over time. At this rate, this much amplitude, that much amplitude, that much amplitude, that's all. Record is that only, out of which is created all this Dolby and, you know, source moving, a chidiya moving from here to there, you surround sound, you can have all these sounds. Just by recording amplitude. The amplitude is of sound is all which is required to record. Similarly, color is all which is required to be recorded. And what do you record when you record a color? But this question is asked differently by people who are doing dyeing or people who are doing photography. There are three different people we worked earlier. You know, they will record, they will have different ways of recording, different culture of recording they will have. And they will also make standards, like you have these cards, no? Palette cards. If you want to paint your house, they will show you these palette cards, choose which one.
Shade cards.
So, or others also, you know. So these are methods of recording. And it's already nearly 6 o'clock.
Yes.
We have not finished this lecture. This lecture is finished, but next lecture is not begun yet. So once you create recording, it creates a situation that you have to get into organization of colors, organization of these amplitudes. You have to get into that. It has to require great conceptual clarity. So which means you have to get into something abstract thing called color spaces. Color spaces have seen through the 10-12 color spaces which have come last 10 to 50 years. Largely because of this visuality, there's a too much of a stress on visuality. People relate this disposition towards visuality to letters. Letters are visual. I mean, so you have signboards. Letters are there. Letters are visual, and so the orality is reducible to visuality, but not the other way around. Visuality wasn't reducible to orality. This is visual information, like gestural information, like dancers give or something like that. That is, you can't speak it out, no. That. But success of letters and is in the Greek alphabets, Armenian alphabets, and the human history has given rise to this visual preponderance of visual culture. And art largely seen as visual. There is no sonic art. Medieval songs are not there. medieval visual things are there. And visuality also is independent of unlike orality, whose apparatus for production and consumption is susceptible to death. But the apparatus of recording visual is not susceptible to death. You can have stones which can have letters written on them for posterity. So visuality can last in its own way, whereas orality disappears in thin air. I mean, what all you said, what all went to thin air, millions of people said million things, so they all went to thin air. And but there is subtle record of that, which we call as memory, cultural memory and things like that. It's also being recorded, but in some other way. And people say that, no, the visual records are externalization of the actual records, which are cultural, which are in our memory, the sanskar, itadi. Smriti. So those are two records, and these are externalizations of this. But externalizations is important because it gives, you go to a temple is externalization of some attitude. So the moment you see that temple, you, that attitude is forced into you, or kind of thing. So these are ways by which visuality is come in. Now visuality to be taken seriously is nothing but color. There's nothing in visuality. Space-time is there. So next lecture is about space-time and color. We look into the color spaces, and last 10 or 50 years have given rise to many color technologies, and look into that portion. And then we will have, yesterday I gave what I'm going to cover. After that, the next lecture would be on pigment art, pigment-based art of color. And then there would be photo color, photo art with color, which is movies and videos and audios, or still photography. And then the last will be summing up into a theory, you know, whatever we're talking.